Welcome to my show. My name is David Letterman, and this is the Tonight Show. Thank you for coming, and I'd just like to firstly thank you for making me the success I am. Thank you. Tonight we have a very full show. We have three very, very special guests. We'll be talking to them on success. What has made them the success that they are? So firstly, I'd like to introduce our first guest. It is Rocky the Bruiser Balboa. Okay, Jack. I have seen all your movies. I've been to them and I've enjoyed them. But I guess the one I really enjoyed was when you sort of, you know, you'd be on a post and you're going like this. That wasn't you. Sorry. Anyway, Jackie, tonight's show is on what makes us successful. What do you put down your success to? What really made you the successful person that you are today?
More success,
you fancy. Or doing your own stunts. I guess that would make you successful. But isn't that how you broke your leg, your broken ribs, broke your skull, broke your nose? No, I guess doing my own stunts would make you so thank you, Jackie, for coming. We're very short tonight. So enjoy your hospital stay. Your ambulance is just waiting outside. And Jackie, one last thing. Have you ever thought about being a train driver or something? Okay. Thank you, people. And thank you, Jackie. Our next very special guest is Elvis the King Presley. I will, people, if you want to know, it was the hips, the legs, all in the, however he does his movement. And that is our tonight show. Thank you, Elvis, for coming. We have seen three very successful people. We've seen what makes them successful. We've seen how they strive and who they are. So my name is David Letterman, and I would like to thank you for coming. And I will see you tomorrow night. Thank you. Thank you.
want you to have the best. Most of us have a perception of success and what it means to us. But some of us trying to obtain that just seems to be out of our reach. The reading today is on Ecclesiastes, chapter 2, verse 1 to 11. I thought in my heart, come now, I will test you with pleasure to find out what is good. But that also proved to be meaningless. Laughter, I said, is foolish. But what does pleasure accomplish? I tried cheering myself with wine and embracing folly. My mind is still guiding me with wisdom. I wanted to see what was worthwhile for men to do under heaven during the days of their lives. I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself and planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks and planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made reservoirs to water groves and flourishing trees. I bought male and female slaves and had other slaves who were born in my house. I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasures of kings and provinces. I acquired men and women singers and a harem as well, the delights of the heart of man. I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all this, my wisdom stayed with me. I denied myself nothing that my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took great delight in all my work, and this was the reward for all my labor. Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. The second reading is from Proverbs chapter 4, 18-19. The path of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn, shining ever brighter till the full light of day. But the way of the wicked is like deep darkness. They do not know what makes them stumble.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 26th Annual Academy Awards. Here are your hosts for this evening, John Hollywood and James Mango.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we have an action-packed and exciting evening in store for you tonight.
Yeah!
That's right, folks. This evening I'm told for us to see great actors and actresses being rewarded for their efforts in the entertainment industry.
Tonight you'll see these performers at their dazzling best. But remember, many actors are nominated, but only one will be selected to win.
Tonight's categories are Best Picture, Best Actor, Best Actress, Best Actor and Actress in a Supporting Role, Best Screenplay and Best Original Music.
But before we find out about these, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back after this presentation.
Thank you.
How do I look?
Meh.
What'll I say when they announce my win? I'd like to thank my agent for his constant hard work. No, I don't want to overdo it. I'd like to thank my wife and children for their love and support during this time. No, they won't do it either. Everyone knows I'm not married. Oh, maybe it'll just come to me.
Thank you very much. Well, I just can't believe my success. No, seems a bit over the top. I just don't know what to say. Thank you to the cast and the crew and all the production team. But
I love you. I love you all. Thank you for your love and support. I really need some of this. This is so rewarding. Oh, sorry. To have your work recognized in this form. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah, that will do. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. And now, for the part of the evening you have all been waiting for. This very prestigious award will probably mean the actor who wins it will have no shortage of roles coming their way in the near future. Who are the nominees, Jane?
If I were to go around the room like this and ask each of you if you could tell me a list of names of people who you thought were successful, I would probably get names like perhaps Jonah Lomu, or perhaps maybe Christian Callum, or maybe Bernice Meni, or Waimata Matomanu, or you may think of world champions like Susan Devoy, or maybe Kathy Miller, or Peter Snell, or John Walker, or maybe Aaron Bader. Alternatively, you may think of people like Sir Edmund Hillary, or Sir Ernest Rutherford, or you may think of Sir Peter Blake, or Sir James Waddy, or maybe Dame Mayo Marsh, or Dame Keith Kanawa. Or you may think of people in other countries like Bill Gates or Nelson Mandela or maybe Professor Albert Einstein or Dr. Albert Schweitzer or maybe Dr. Graham Alexander Bell or Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
Or Michael Jackson, or Michael Johnson, or you may think of Tom Hanks, Tom Cruise, or perhaps Claudia Schiffer.
Yeah.
Now, if you look at all of these people and try to compare yourself with those, then, and their achievements, then you'll be both probably inspired and also discouraged. Inspired because there's no doubt that each of those people are very successful in what they've done. But discouraged also, perhaps, because for each of us, none of us seems to be like them. We're not as young as Anna Paquin, or not as old as Sir Edmund Hillary. We're not as big as Joan Lawman. We're not as agile as Christian Cullen. We're not as fast as Michael Johnson. We can't fly like Michael Jordan. Right? We're not as tall as some of these people. We're not as strong as Kathy Millen. We're not as versatile as Erin Bain. We're not as fit as Susan Devoy. We're not as intelligent as Bill Gates. We're not as good looking as Tom Cruise. We're not as beautiful as Michelle Pfeiffer. So when we measure ourselves against these people, we just don't measure up physically and, in some cases, intellectually. But I could also read you out a list, a long list, countless people on it, who are just as successful, and in many cases, even more successful. And in this list, there are people, there are blind people, there are deaf people, there are dumb people in terms of they cannot speak, there are crippled people, there are intellectually handicapped people, there are weak people, there are fat people, there are skinny people, there are ordinary people like you and me. And if you were to look at what lies behind their success, you would find that without exception, all of them, were driven to succeed by a dream which they would not let go, which they held on to, no matter what happened to them. And all of them have three common characteristics. So one, courage, two, determination, and three, sacrifice. And they all faced obstacles and adversity, problems which they had to overcome. And they overcame them because of those three things: courage, determination, and sacrifice. To put it in someone else's words, blood, sweat, and tears. Blood, sacrifice. Sweat for determination. Tears for courage. And there's a man which most people probably know or heard about, and that's Martin Luther King. And he said, every man should have something that they would be prepared to die for. Any man who doesn't is not fit to live. That's pretty deep. But every one of us can succeed. Everyone can succeed with those three things: blood, sweat, and tears. Courage, determination, and sacrifice. Everyone can stand at the top of the mountain. And I hope that you will choose the right mountain to climb. A mountain that is worthy of your blood, and worthy of your sweat, and worthy of your tears. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. We're going to take up an offering right now, and as the bags are moved down the rows, moved down the aisles and across the rows, if you're a visitor here, you just pass the bag onto the person next to you, and as that's happening, I'm just going to pray for that offering, right? Father, we just thank you that when it came to you, that there was no shortage of blood and sweat and tears. And we thank you for all that you've given us. And this morning, we want to give some of that back to you. We ask that you take it, that you bless it, that you multiply it, and you give wisdom to those who will use it. In Jesus' name. It was said.
Amen.
After, well, it's just been taken up. After the service this morning, There's going to be a cup of tea and some morning tea outside there, straight after the service. So you're all most welcome to join us, and we'd love to share that with any visitors here. Now, we have the remainder of the awards. So I shall leave the stage.
Thank you.
Let's give them another hand for that, eh? Man? Success. I feel pretty good after Tessa's introduction earlier. I sat there and I figured I've got a body a little bit near Christian Collins, a little bit like John Lumos. So between the two of them, I'm sharing their success. What do you reckon?
Yeah.
You see, it all depends on your perceptions and your perspectives, doesn't it? You know, if you get two people look at half a glass of water, one person will say it's half empty, but the optimist will say it's half full. One person will see what's gone, and the other person will see the possibilities that are still there. And that often is the difference between those who see success and those who don't. How do you view success? How do you view success? Because ultimately, the way in which we view success will actually affect the way in which we live. The way you view success will affect the decisions that you make and will cause you to act the way that you do. Some people equate success in all sorts of ways. You know the common joke about a certain race of people? Well, you get this picture where they've got a grenade in their hand and success is perceived in their culture to be such where they pull the pin from the grenade and they remember to throw the right bit. That's success for some. Or maybe it's like some of the people who I've met in my past. One of them is wandering around the stage here this morning. The typical yuppie. He came in this morning and I couldn't resist her. From the corner. I remember when yuppies were first an invention of society. I was down Queen Street in Auckland at the time. I happened to go up to Auckland. And I had this little streak in me that sometimes just cannot resist temptation. And there were the three yuppies there. In a group, standing on the curb, beside the road. Two of them were having this intense discussion and making big overtures of what they were saying with their hands and their body. The third one was standing right on the curb, on his toes, with his cell phone in his hand, and he had his loud tie which he was stroking, and he was doing his thing, yuppie-wise, on the phone. I don't know who he was talking to or whether he was talking to anybody. But I couldn't resist. So I wound the window down, I was just by the traffic lights, and I stuck my finger out the window and went, "Nice one!" And he looked at me with stark horror, and he went, like this. You see, we like to be seen as successful, but if somebody sees through the veneer, we suddenly feel exposed, and we want to hide. I remember one morning in Auckland when we were living there, there was a story that came across the radio, the local pop station. The disc jockey told of the story that there'd been an accident at the bottom of Queen Street. And there was somebody terribly injured and they were in need of desperate help. So they leapt out, it was late at night, they leapt out of the car and they raced up the cars and tapped on people's windows, because they hadn't been aware further back that there'd been a serious accident. Tapped on people's windows asking if they had a cell phone. And nobody had a cell phone until they got to this one very flash car. I can't remember what make it was, I just remember it was flash. And there was this guy sitting there talking away on his cell phone. So the guy pounded on the window. And the chap looked out from his sort of cell phone and looked at him strangely and carried on. And he pounded on the window again, and they looked at him really strangely, and he carried on. So the guy got really irate, and he yelled at him and pounded on the window. So in the end, the guy pushed the button, and the window lowered itself, and he said, "What would you like?" He says, "We need your cell phone urgently. There's somebody been badly injured just down the road. Here, we need your cell phone." And much to the chagrin of the man who had the cell phone in his hand, he had to admit that it was actually a fake, and it was a game.
who is playing to impress others. You remember the phones? You push the button and it would ring. You remember them? I know some of you in this congregation who own one. Pulled a few people with it. He wasn't intending to use it in that way, but he just teased some of us. You see, today it is so important to succeed. You get all sorts of motivational seminars, you get all sorts of opportunities. Hypnotists say that, and there's one very popular one advertising on TV, that if you buy into my system, my program, my belief, my structure, my hypnotism, then you will succeed. That's the message. It's so important to succeed. And the importance of success has added incredible weight on our lifestyles, our thoughts, and our actions. And nobody can escape it. Well, there's plenty of things they have. I can think of a group when I was younger, and I didn't have this sort of nice hairdo, you know. I had long hair down here, and I used to think it was short. It was years later, I looked at a photograph. After we'd been married for some years, and we had our girls by this stage, they were old enough to be looking at photographs and having a few laughs. I came across this photo of me, white man. I couldn't believe how long my hair was. Somebody had faked the photograph. Somebody had mucked around with it, you know. It was the first thought, and then I realised it really was me. My perceptions about myself were quite wrong, but I had lots of friends who got right into the hippie lifestyle because they were sick and tired of society's pressure on success. So they set their own agendas. So their success was, can I space out more than somebody else and get away with it? Oh, it was still a success measure. They just thought it wasn't, that's all. Society has been cut loose from a moral fabric that it's had for so long. It's cut loose from its religious and philosophical moorings that we've previously had. And in the end, it's now rejected the belief in absolute truth. There is no truth. And there's been many philosophers who've stated that so clearly. So everything has become what we call relative. Nothing to do with Tepper's relatives, who are famous. They're all relative in the sense of, if I think it's all right, then it's fine. And we wonder why in our society crime is on the increase. Suicide has come to astronomical proportions in New Zealand. We're one of the worst countries in the world. We wonder why people decide to do things that seem totally selfish. And we're sometimes wrecked and shocked as we see the things that people do. And yet often we buy into this whole relativity thing. There is no defined point of measure. And people are lost in this abyss of nothingness when everything is relative. You see, if there are no clear boundaries, if there's no absolute truth, then you can do what you like and justify it. You can set your own boundaries. And even if society says there are some boundaries, I will keep pushing it because I don't believe in boundaries. That's the heart's cry of today's society. That is the heart's cry of success in a sense. But like Kerry read from the scripture before, the writer talked about having everything. He had the wealth, he had a harem, he had everything. And a man's eyes of his age. At the end of it, he sat down in his wisdom and he thought about it and he said, it's all meaningless. Totally meaningless. Life is meaning. Lost its meaning, sorry. Life, in fact, has lost its significance. And so suicide, euthanasia, theft, in fact, any form of meism,
rise itself like a serpent's head, and it struck us with its poison. And when society are sometimes reeling from the effects. There was a young man who used to spend a bit of time ringing me, not for any help spiritually or anything like that. He's into electronics. And recently his brother came home to discover that this young man had decided that life just wasn't worth living. That was a very, very painful thing for that family. He just didn't achieve the way he felt he should be, and it was too much. And still people speak about and desire success. They search for it in all sorts of ways. And I want to say that applies to every person here to some measure or another. Some people's success is to fail, you know that? Their greatest success is to fail in the eyes of others. That's why we ended up with a major problem in Porirua for some years. It's not so much a problem now as it was. With streeties. It was a rebellion. It was saying, I am not going to conform to what you expect of me in society. I'm going to do my thing and I will succeed at what I want to do. And literally, everybody else can go to hell. In the strictest terms. So we've ended up with a society where you'll notice that the only form of real success for a lot of people at the moment that's left for them to search for is cultural success. And so we've got all sorts of adventures back into history. And unfortunately, if we're really serious about that, we have to think about history and realize that in itself is the very thing we should avoid. We look back at history and we look at all the mistakes in history and we think we're not going to make the same mistakes, and yet, philosophically, every culture that has failed and every culture has failed because of certain weaknesses that are there. And we're searching for them so often. And we want to say that success is just really another can of worms. It's just another can of worms that we haven't recognized and that's sitting there looking at us. So we end up with this thing I talked about before called relativism. This thing with no basis of truth has its own definition of success. Let me give it to you. Today, there need be no real work, no real accomplishment, and no real achievement involved. The new success is open to everyone. I remember a discussion my girls had when they were in Cannon Street School near here. They came home one day, and one of them said, Dad, I want to be naughty. And what do you do when your daughters sit there and tell you they want to be naughty? I said, why? Why do you want to be naughty? They said, because the naughty kids are the only ones that are getting certificates at our school. And they were right. I was treasurer of that school. And I went and I talked to the headmaster and I said, do you realise that there's a lot of good kids in your school that are feeling the best way to achieve, to get success in this school, is to first be bad so that they can do one little good thing so that they can get a reward. And that school, last week, I had one of the parents from this church tell me that the same thing's still happening to their kids. And it's happening, it's not just Cannon Creek, it's all over the place. It's a popular thing. It's all relative, you see. There's no particular standards except the standard you will achieve personally. So to hang with the fact that you may have beaten up, kicked, bitten, spat at, been nasty to teachers and other kids in this class, if you one day do one good thing, you're going to get a prize, even though the other kids have done good things all week and have never received a single reward. That's relativism at its worst. Indeed, there's a man called Christopher Leischuser, who's a popular writer and has done a lot of thinking on this whole issue. And he said this, indeed, it has no reference to anything outside the self. The new idealism of success has no content whatsoever. You don't have to have any substance to be successful. All you need to do is to look successful. I'd love to borrow Chris's cell phone and walk down the street for a couple of weeks. And then I'd love to be the fly on the wall that heard people talk about the pastor with the cell phone. I guarantee, even some people in this congregation wouldn't be able to resist some little comment. It's true. Some would see it as a mark of success. Others would say, boy, he's degenerated into deep sin. They are the petite perception, says all relative. Has no real substance, has no real foundation. You can look motivated or even demotivated, and it won't matter. You can still be successful in the eyes of this world today. For some people, if you're the weirdest, the richest, or maybe the worst, you're a success. Have you noticed that? Some of the popular images that we follow in our society today, if we really thought about what those people are doing, if we really grappled with the issues that were in their lives, we would be concerned for them, not glorifying them. It's true. Some of the names that Tepa named earlier are people who have achieved greatly in a certain area, but have failed in life. And we all know it. The saying goes to society, you look successful, you are. I remember a funny incident a while ago. Somebody I know well, some of you know, went to the bank to get a loan. And I was intrigued because he knew how to work the system. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. But what he did, he dressed in this beautiful suit, looked really, really smart. He had two of these pens in his top left-hand pocket. Now, I had only been recently introduced to these pens, and some of you probably don't know about these pens, but they're worth a lot of money. And that on the top of them, they look like snow sort of falling on the top of a mountain. And I can't remember the name of these pens, but they're very flash things. And he walks into the bank manager and he says, I want a loan. And I'm sure the bank manager looked at him and thought, this guy's really impressive. And he got the loan. Unbelievable rates, an unbelievable response, an unbelievable loan. If I'd gone in there looking the way I was that week, and I said to him, I've come here because I want to buy a house, and I want a loan, I've got no deposit, I'd like a full loan, the bank manager would have probably looked at me and says, get off the grass. Because he wouldn't have perceived me as being successful, even dressed like I am now. I'm not a success in the terms of men. I choose not to be successful clothing-wise. I thought about as a pastor. Do I dress and look successful? Aha. Who then do people follow? Me? Or Jesus? Real problem, real dilemma for pastors. You just don't know what pastors have to go through sometimes. I cut my hair because I could go to a funeral. I came here yesterday. There's a group of people here, even this morning, there's a group of people here who gave me a hard time. Some of them told me I look like Derek. I wasn't sure how to take it.
It's a miracle.
It's a miracle. Others told me I look swore. I went to the funeral, there's a whole group of pastors there, and I felt really, really good because one of the guys, there's a group of us all standing together, and one of the guys turned to me, and he used to live next door to us in Auckland when we were there. He said, "Hey, Gary, you get right up my nose." So what the hang have I done now? I said, "What's that?" He said, "You still look the same age as you did 11 years ago. How do you do it?" Oh boy, did I feel good! I was successful, yes! I held my age! Then I stopped and thought about what I've just been through in the previous 2 weeks. Lying in bed with the flu and abs and aches and pains. I got up to Taupo and we were on holiday because I knew I needed to get away. I get up there and I got over the flu and then I pinched a nerve somewhere and I got pain in the shoulder and I could hardly drive my car, you know, and I wanted to go to Kawera, but I couldn't. And then when that pain disappeared, the same nerve pinch must have got me somewhere else because I went to go to bed and my muscle would go, and it would calm down for about 10 minutes and I'd lay there, you know, screaming inside me. Well, that's not really success. My body's giving me some messages. I've been pushing it too hard. That's failure. But as long as I learn from it, it changes. You see, we can look successful. We can dress for success. I'm sure some of you, when you came here this morning, you thought, I'm going to look really good this morning. I want to look really good. Now, some of you may not have thought that way. Some of you probably thought, especially some of you who are visiting here today, thought, "Good grief, what do I put on when I go to this church? Huh? Do I put a tie on? Or do I not put a tie on? Do I wear a long dress? Or do I wear a shorter dress? Do I make myself look really flash? Or do I sort of tone it down? What are these Christian guys going to think of me?" Well, Christians think things of each other sometimes, not always very helpful, but it shouldn't, but it does happen. But it happens in society a lot. There's a guy I know, his name's Bruce Sachs, and I know why I'm sharing this, because he's given me permission in the past to share it. His mother, when he was born, had tooth poisoning. It's bees were carrying pollen from the toot plant, which is a poisonous plant. And they didn't know that there were toot plants nearby and they had hives and beehives and the mother got toot poisoning. And the consequence of it is that Bruce has a mobility problem. His motor movements are limited. His speech, he has difficulty speaking. He has a little bit of trouble walking. And it's quite hard for Bruce. When he was a young man, he had 10 acres of land, I think it was, and he got into kiwi fruit. He's one of the first in New Zealand into it. He's a shrewd guy because he got his brothers to help him build the vine stands and everything. Everybody helped him because Bruce couldn't do it all on his own. In any case, he ended up, after a few years, selling his kiwi fruit, and he works at Caxton Mill in Kawerau as a painter. And Bruce had a whole series of accidents. He kept falling, because of his mobility problems, he kept falling down holes, and he broke his leg twice and his arm, one arm once and the other arm another time. He did all sorts of damage to himself. And in the end, we actually got so concerned for him, we prayed for him that he wouldn't have any more accidents, and he hasn't to this day, by the way. But the guys at work tease Bruce. Because he has a difficulty with speech, they go, "Oh, silly Bruce." That's what they say to him, in front of his face. "Silly Bruce, come on, silly Bruce." Bruce came to me one day and he said, "These guys, they laugh at me." I said, "Silly Bruce. But what they don't know is," he said, "when I sold my kiwi fruit farm, I got $1.2 million for it." He said, "I own half the shops in Kawerau, and they don't know." He said, "They think I'm silly. They're the silly buggers." And that's a different way of saying it. It was funny. You know? See, we measure success in the wrong way so often, don't we? see, you can look successful and not be that. Mm. And like Bruce, you can look unsuccessful and actually be very, very successful. Mm. Success, how does it affect me? How does it affect you and I? Whether we know it or not, a concept of success is a part of our own worldview. We will measure ourselves against others in all sorts of strange ways. Can I do this? Can't I do that? Sometimes we'll allow our neighbours to push us. The neighbour buys a boat. Oh, he couldn't have a boat. Now, that's actually not so much a problem nowadays as it used to be. In the 1950s and onwards, the man of the house was expected to go out, not the woman, and earn as much money as he possibly could for his family to buy the latest house, the latest boat if they could, and a TV. Wow, that was really special. So old black and white things with lines running through them, but that was, you know, magic. And many, many men have followed that dream. Today I think it's much more complex than that, and there are all sorts of different expectations in terms of success. Some people see it as owning property, other people see it not so much as doing that, as to be seen to be successful. But we've got lots of pressure on us to succeed. And we need to be aware of what our notion of success is. We need to be aware of what its roots are and what the implications are for our lives. Whatever model of success we're buying into or we have bought into, what is it that's affecting us? We need to be sure that our perspective on success and failure is beneficial for ourselves, for our families, and for our community. And if anybody dares to say, I don't give a hoot, I don't give a stuff what anybody else thinks, and for me, then I want to say something to you. That is failure in the worst possible sense. That is not success. You may own everything, you may have everything, you may possess everything that this world can supply, but that will only leave you feeling empty. You know Howard Hughes? Have you heard of him? He was considered to be one of the most successful men. But near the end of his life, he built a plane. Do you remember what it's called? The Spruce Goose. It actually flew, but it never flew. Because what happened, it was the largest plane that had been built in those days. But the fear had come to the point where it was filling Howard Hughes' life so deeply that the only thing he was prepared to do with that plane was to fly it just above the surface of the sea and do a figure eight and to land it, and that was the sole flight of that plane. You see, he became so possessed with fear, his success had driven him into a place where he always anticipated the worst failure. He couldn't stand woman being near him. And it was the inverse effect of the fact that he'd been so possessed by woman when he was younger that in the end he came to fear the possibility of catching a disease from them, and so he wouldn't allow them to attend to him. And whenever any person handled anything, any woman in the staff handled anything, they had to wear white gloves. And even men were asked to do the same. So we must be sure that our perspective on success and failure is beneficial all round. And the two steps that we can take to do that, and I want to define those two steps this morning. First of all, we must critique the definitions of success that we know. They must be analysed for their values and the results they'll bring us in the end. We must give a good critique. We must study, analyse, and look at the things that we value most. And check it out. I want you to do something for me. Tepper did it earlier and I thought, he's going to steal my thunder. But he didn't. I want you to think of three people that you know to be famous, that you consider to be truly, truly successful. Now let me define what that means. That means that they were beneficial to themselves and to society at large. Three people. Name it. Three. Something give us one name.
God, Jesus, Holy Spirit.
No. Come on, give some people. Sorry?
Michael Jones.
Martin Luther King.
Bill Gates.
Right? Yeah, Cliff Richard. Interesting. Okay, let's give us some other names. A little bit, stretch us a little bit more.
Mother Teresa.
Anybody else?
Mahatma Gandhi.
Abraham Lincoln.
Sorry?
Judy Dench.
Oh, okay, actress. Okay, I haven't clicked. Okay?
Here's the
pope. Okay, let me ask you another question then. Name some well-known people who are known for their successes, but you put a but at the end of it.
Madonna.
Who else?
Michael Jackson.
Who else? Elvis. Okay, get into some political figures now. Wait for musicians. Singers.
Kennedy.
Nixon. Come on, you guys. Stretch a bit more.
Princess Diane.
Who else?
David Longing.
Goodness me. I would have gone a bit more extreme and said Hitler or Napoleon or somebody like that, really famous, you know?
Who?
No, not.
You see, most of those people started out with ideals and they wanted to achieve those things, but the thing was that they went about it the wrong way and they did the wrong things in the process, and we know it. Let's take a definition of success. Here's a good definition of success that I found. It means attaining some measure of money, fame, power, and self-fulfillment, and then looking the part. That's a popular secular world view of success. I'll read it again. It means attaining some measure of money, fame, power, and self-fulfillment, and then looking the part. That's interesting, isn't it? But at what expense? In the 50s, many men worked hard for their money. But the end product was that they alienated their families because they just weren't there for them. And that's why we've got so many solo families, and it's sad. And it's not blaming those solo people. A society has set a trend that has affected us all. It can leave us a feeling as if success is continually eluding us. And we somehow feel less real, less substantial, and less meaningful. You know, the pressure's even on pastors. If the church doesn't grow fast enough, you're not successful. Listen to it. Really carefully. Push it down further. If your business doesn't come out with decent profits, then you were not successful. Sure, you might have lived a good year's life. Or is it that you weren't really successful? Not in the eyes of people. You see, the trouble is that we need meaning. And if there's no meaning there, then it's not success. Sometimes we face momentary pleasure. You know, we enjoy ourselves doing things. But afterwards we feel empty. And the trouble is that success is devoid of any kind of meaning. It's failure in itself. For all its appeal, success can often be deadly, demanding, and dangerous. Because it can be at the expense of others. So I want to just touch briefly on things we can develop and discover to have healthy model of success and failure. A healthy model of success and failure. You know that it's often said in trade and other areas of life that no man has ever built a successful life without failing. Because, you see, often, and I find this, I learn by the failures, by the mistakes I make. Sometimes that's the only way I learn because I'm a bit thick sometimes. Don't you agree? No, not about me, about yourself, please. Right? There was a young man at 16 years old, his name was William. And he had to leave home because his dad could no longer support him. This was many years ago. And William was walking along the canal in London, and what happened, I think it was London Heathrow, I'm just trying to remember. And he met a canal captain, a captain of a canal boat. And the captain said, "What are you doing, William?" And William said to him, "Well, Dad's told me I have to go. They can't continue to support me. I've got to go and make my own way in life." And the captain said two very interesting things to William. He said, "Let me give you two bits of advice. So first of all, what are you good at?" He said, "Well, the only thing I know how to do is, Dad's a man who makes soap. He's not been very good at it, but he knows how to do it. And he taught me how to make soap." The canal captain sat there for a moment and he said, "If you go up to New York, New York's a place that needs somebody who can make soap." And he said, "But let me give you some advice." He said, "You go and make soap. You do it the best way you can." He said, "You really work at it." And he said, "You let me pray for you before you go." He said, "But if I pray for you, I want you to promise me one thing, that when you start receiving the benefits of your soap making, you give credit to God who allows you to do it by giving him some returns." He didn't tell him how much. And right there, this wise old captain knelt down beside the canal and he prayed for William and he prayed that God would make him successful. Now, I don't know whether you know who this man was, but his surname was Colgate. And we all know the success story that he had. He became the most successful soap maker in New York, as predicted by this man. But the thing was, he didn't only succeed in the making of soap, but he did the thing the canal captain asked him to do, to remember the God who gave him the power to do what he was doing. Some of you know the story of Amway, the success I've had there. But what you may not know is that that is founded as a Christian business. And although not everybody who works in Amway is Christian, the principles and the basis of the organisation is purely so. I'm going to go through a list of things that are true success. I'd like you to grab these in your heart. True success is not the absence of failure. True success has integrity, doing what's right. It is a freedom from corruption or any influence that would be destructive in your life. True success has no guilt attached to it. True success takes courage when others would back off. True success means loyalty, faithfulness to principles, to plan, and to people, not just to yourself. True success is not based on the most ability that a person might have, but on those who conquer the fear of failure, and often the people with the greatest ability are not successful. Often the best people that are most successful are ones who have little ability, but have worked at it. True success is not whether you look good or look bad. I think if John Olumu hadn't been a top All Black, he may not have been considered so handsome. I'm the never thought him to be particularly so. I think he's a big, strong brute of a man. I'm not saying he's ugly, but I guess it's in the eye of the beholder. True success means you're going to have endurance, you're going to push all the way through. True success accepts one thing, and this is the one that crunches most people. Accept that God is true, and that there are absolutes of truth. You see, one day, we're going to have to face our Maker, and then success will be truly measured, and only then. The quotation I found: if there is no God, then wrangling over success and failure is nothing more than a joke. Think about that seriously. If there is no God, then wrangling over success or failure is a joke. Because if there is no God, there is no absolute truth. And so there is no such thing as success, really. It's all relative. And it's empty. But if God exists, then our questions about failure and success are linked with what it means to live. What it means to live with God present in this world. And what it means to know what we're going to be measured by one day. And my recommendation to every one of us here is that we live in such a way that our success may not be that we have a big business or we own the greatest house or we have any other material thing. But at the end of the day, that God would be able to say to us, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." That is true success. Mother Teresa has nothing. Martin Luther King had nothing. Abraham Lincoln had little in the terms of what we would normally equate success, except that they did have God. They did understand that life wasn't just a relative jumble of stuff that you could just choose to reject or accept. And the greatest key to experiencing a joyful and a fulfilling and a successful life, both now and for eternity, is to invest in it now for eternity. And I want to say this morning, folks, that what was said when Curly read the scripture this morning, that you can chase after all those things, and at the end of the day, life can be meaningless. And I want to recommend this morning that the greatest success in the world is to know God. I could have been in business, I could have been making a lot of money. And now and again I go through stages thinking, "Oh, I would like that." You know, it's honest. But most of the time I know that it would just leave me feeling empty. I wouldn't be satisfied like I am. I want the best. And I'm sure you do. I'm going to pray a prayer, and I invite you to join me when I pray this prayer. If you'd like to, then feel free. You don't have to close your eyes or anything. You can leave them open or you can close them. Whatever you choose. There's no sort of thing about how to pray. It's just talking to God. When I talk to you, I keep my eyes open most of the time. That's fair enough. I'm going to pray a prayer, but I'm going to close my eyes just so that it gives you some privacy. But it also means that I can focus on God easier. That's my way of fine. And if you'd like to say amen at the end, if you want to agree with this prayer, I'm going to say it, and all the people say, and if you say want to say amen with me, then you say that. Let's pray. Lord God, I know, Lord, that at different times in my life I've failed. I haven't succeeded in the way that perhaps you've wanted me to succeed, and I need to work through that, Lord. I need to hear your voice I need to understand what it is to walk with you, to know you. And God, for some of us here, we haven't really talked to you for a long time, or we've maybe never talked to you, or maybe we haven't been talking to you enough lately. We want to be people who are successful in the right way. So help us, Lord, we pray. We know that when you died, Jesus said to him, that was seen as failure, but in actual fact, it turned out to be success. Help us to understand what it means to live in you and to know you and to have you living with us. In Jesus' name. And all the people said,
Amen.